Welcome back to Steve Robb Reviews. Today we're going to have a lot of fun. I'm not going to make anybody do any math. I'm going to do all the math myself, and it's all about power inverters. And this is the power inverter that I'm going to be using today, just a 300 watt power inverter. And this is the specs right there. Okay, today we are going to delve into what is the efficiency of a power inverter and how do you actually check it. And you're going to witness voltage drop, which is exactly what it sounds like. When voltage drops, amperage goes up. Why does that make a difference when you have a power inverter? Well, today I'm going to show you in this little 300 watt power inverter how all these relationships actually make a huge difference for anybody who's considering to buy a power inverter, and what they can actually plug into it and what then they can expect to have for cables to plug into their particular battery that they have. Now this is a 12 volt system today, and this particular experiment, well, it's not really an experiment. This particular values recording is going to be used with Ohm's law to show you that you can test what goes into your power inverter from your DC supply, and you can test what comes out of your inverter in AC voltage and AC amperage. And we're going to check both at both ends, compare the difference, and record the efficiency of whatever inverter you have. Because if you're looking at getting a particular appliance that runs off of wattage, how does that relate to your power inverter? Well, a lot of people think you can just do Ohm's law and you're honky-dory and everything's fine, right? No. It doesn't quite work like that, because you've got all the losses that go through your power inverter as well. You've got losses going through your cables, all your connections. There's all kinds of different losses that actually cause a voltage drop. And as I said in the beginning, as your voltage drops, your amperage increases. When your amperage increases, well, you really have to know how many amps your particular conductor cable from the back of your power inverter going to your battery bank, how large does it have to be depending on the amount of space between the two distances, either it's in feet, yards, meters. It all makes a difference. So let's get to the experiment right here. Well, the value recording, and let's take a look and see what we got. Well, let's start off at the battery end. So you can see I've got a fully charged battery, 12.7. Down here I've got my amp clamp set up, so I am going to get a reading from the battery connection going to the inverter. Coming out of the inverter, I have my AC amp clamp, and that is going to take a reading coming out. These two probes here are for my voltage coming out. That's just ghost voltage, don't worry about that for now. And down here I've got my watt meter. So what I'm going to do here is I have a 100 watt bulb, and I'm going to turn the 100 watt bulb on, and then we're going to look at the values. So let's just turn the power inverter on, if I can do that. Now the first thing you notice is nothing happened to the battery voltage. If we take a look down here, yes, and that is the proper spec. It's about 300 milliamps just to turn this unit on and have it run. Now there's no amperage going through the AC side, and the voltage is 127. Now you'll see in a lot of these smaller inverters that they will have a high startup voltage, but you're going to see how they drop when you turn the when you turn any load on. Okay, so down here is, I got the watt meter plugged in, so you can actually verify this is a 100 watt bulb, and it is going to register 94 watts. Now let's come over to our volts here, and we're already down to a voltage drop of 12.1. Take a look at our amperage reading. 8.4. What you have to really look for is a stabilization of your voltage. So we got in between 12 and 12.1 and 8.4, 8.5. As the voltage drops, the amperage will go up, but we got 8.5. Yeah, on the 120 volt side, it's 8.2. So it's almost 1 amp. And what are we? We're still at 94 watts. So we got 8, and I'll just turn it this way here so we can actually verify that. Yeah, it's 0.82 at 100 and not 20, 115.44. So numbers do matter, right? It's not 120 volt. 0.82. We're going to go with 0.82. It's almost an amp. And we're down to here. Yeah, we're going to call that 8.4. And it hasn't budged really here. So 12.1. We started at 12.7, I believe. So what does all this actually mean? So I'm going to get a piece of paper and pencil, and we're gonna do some math. Well, here we go. I did the math, and if we just take a look at the DC side of the circuit, the voltage was 12.1. we had a recording of 8.4 amps. Now if you do Ohm's law, you take your load, which is 94 watts, you divide it by your voltage, 12.1, and we get 7.7 amps. Now on the AC side, you had 115.45 volts. The amperage was 0.82. So if we do Ohm's law, we got 94 watts. You divide it by your voltage, and we have 0.81. Now that's very close to the 0.82, you know, because the amp clamp, you know, is not exactly the highest resolution. But you could see that there's a correlation here, you know, 0.82 and 0.81 compared to the 8.4 amps and Ohm's law, which is 7.7. So if we take a look at the efficiency or the inefficiency, so if we do Ohm's law, you take 7.7 amps compared to the actual reading, which is 8.4, the differential is 0.07. Now, 7.7 amps, you just take a factor of 10%, and that's 0.77. So yes, this actual inverter, when you load it to 94 watts, you are losing 10% in efficiency. And that's also 10% loss between the DC side of the circuit and the AC side of the circuit when you're trying to figure out wattage. So yes, there's a 10% loss between these cables that attach to the battery and what you got out the front here in AC voltage or your amperage draw or your wattage. There was 10% difference between here and out of here, and that makes a huge difference. Now if you're taking a look at this particular inverter here, it's a 300 watt inverter, and that's 150 watt aside. So we loaded it up pretty good on the one side because it was 94 watts, right? Now I predict that you would not get as much of a loss at a lower wattage amount. So what I've noticed with inverters is as you load them up more, yeah, you'll get more of a voltage drop and you'll get more of a loss. So depending on your inverter, you buy like a $25 inverter, you could expect to get $25 worth of efficiency, right? So, you know, really that's what it comes down to. Now, this is a great relationship between the DC side and the AC side when you're thinking about wattage. Because a lot of people will just look at their particular appliance and say, okay, I've got, you know, a specific size inverter, and I can take a look at the specs on the back of my appliance here. I go by the wattage, and I just plug it in, right? Well, no, there's a huge difference there. As you can see here, there's a 10% difference. So when you're thinking about just your cables, how do you size your cables? Well, the best thing to do is measure. Because as you can see here today, there is a 10% loss in efficiency between the battery side to the output side in AC. And that's something that a lot of people have to consider about, because, you know, there's a lot of different reasons why you have voltage drop and power losses. And a lot of it has to do with using like alligator clips, insufficient cabling. There's all kinds of different reasonings. Matching your battery up specifically. There's all kinds of different reasons. And that's the fun part about solar and using off-grid appliances. Now, the one thing I will say is a lot of people decided to go to strictly DC appliances. And of course, you would not get these losses because you're not going through an inverter, right? But just think about if you wanted to go to a DC appliance. You know, I've mentioned before, I've got a regular 4.5 cubic foot fridge up at my cabin, and it cost me $160. If I tried to buy the same size fridge, you know, in a really nice unit, you're about $1,000. So, I mean, it depends how you want to build your system. And remember, when you're talking about DC loads, you have to attach the proper cabling to match the amperage of your load. And in my experience, if your appliances are close to your batteries, the DC may be a good choice. But if they're a distance apart, like in mine, you know, I've got quite a large distance in between where my fridge is and where my battery bank is, I would have to run like huge cables to run that distance. And for me, it's not really feasible. I like going the inverter way, and I find it's the most economical as well. But you just have to know the losses. And in this particular situation, yeah, it's a 10% loss on this. So thanks for joining me here today. I hope you found this interesting of some sort, because you can actually do the exact same thing to your inverter and test the Ohm's law relationship of amperage, wattage, and voltage. Check the back side, the DC side, then compare it to the AC side using the same amount of wattage, and you can check your efficiency. So thanks for joining me here today. If you haven't seen this channel before, you're welcome to subscribe. Come back again and have some more fascinating ideas that I come up with on testing different things. Cheers.